the victim, man. A victim of just reckless violence. He was 17 years old, and somewhere before his senior year, and he went to a party, and they shot up the house. Someone shot up the house while he was there at the party. He hadn't been there for 5 minutes, and he was shot. He was shot in the car, right underneath his collarbone. It punctured his lung, and he died of, he basically bled to death. He choked on his own blood. His lungs filled up with blood, and the saddest thing about it all was they called 911, and the 911 operator actually hung up on him. So, it's a nationwide story, but, they called the 911, and the 911 operator hung up on the person that was calling for help, and he didn't make it. He died in the hospital. My 2-year-old's pool party, her birthday party. She was going to be a lifeguard at the pool, and we were going to have a party in my house, and I was expecting him, and then I got the call in the morning. I cry all the time. I think about him, and it devastates me that they can't find his murderer. They can't. And the worst part about it is, it's a drive-by shooting, so there's no proof. The police department, they have their lead, but it's one of those things, it's hard to get any closure knowing that you pulled that trigger out there. Not serving any punishment for taking one of my friends, a good person, an athlete, a good kid's life. This kid was not a punk. He was not a little drug dealer. He was a good kid. He played football. He wrestled. Very, very sad thing. So I dedicate this fight for him. I think that he's gonna be with me on my shoulder. I'm out there fighting with me. Every training session, I dedicate it to him. And that's my hero. He's my little buddy. Gone.
I'm sorry to hear that, Diego. That's a horrible story. So young, man. My condolences, my heart goes out to you and of course your family and friends. It feels to me, Diego, like you entered this fight sort of a this experience, which is, you can't even put it into words, but even some of your tweets and you tweeting about the odds and you tweeting about the people who are doubting you. Even my first question was about featherweight. It feels like you feel, correct me if I'm wrong, a lot of people are kind of out here that are just kind of saying, what is Diego doing? And that you want to prove a lot of people wrong. Is that fair?
Definitely. Yeah, that's what I was telling you, how, I know my last performances were not my best. And I know that I've had some rough tactics, but I feel good, man. I fought Gilbert Melendez to a very amazing fight. I showed some great moments, and no way am I supposed to be done. People don't really take into consideration that I've been fighting the best in the UFC for 10 years. 10 years straight, I've been fighting the best. I never took no slouches. I never took no easy fights. I always was looking to fight the best guys. So, for people to count me out and consider me washed up and done, it bothers me. I look at those people and I don't get angry at them. I just look at them and I'm like, who are you? Not me. I'm the expert in this field. I know what I'm doing. who are you to tell me? You know, you're just some little punk on Twitter, you know, looking to get a rise out of a professional mixed martial arts fighter. And so for me, that's it bothers me a lot of people are like, no. But at the same time, I tell them that. And it's a quota. And, you know, there's a lot of people out there that tell me every day, you know, look here, you know, you put on the greatest fight, you fight with the biggest heart, and you fight the way you want to fight, you fight, you know, you fight, you're a real fighter. And so, I know my fans are out there, you know, and I'm fighting for that, I'm fighting for my fans, I'm fighting for the people who support me, and for the people who believe in me. But I really do feel that at 135 pounds, it's where I am. You know, I walk around, Ariel, my literally walk around weight is about 174. Yeah, that's me walking around. And not even, maybe 10% body fat. You know, walking around at about 10% body fat. So, you know, for me, I'll cut another 10 pounds and in the next 2 weeks and I'll be... be 165, and I'll be looking to cut and like everybody else. And that's where the sport has gone right now. Everybody's from weight. I see these 5 pounders that are big. You know, these guys are big. Even just seeing Nate Diaz, and you know, in real life, you see the guy. He's big. He looks like about 180, 190. You know, maybe 200 pounds. And so, for me, I'm like, well, you know, I'm tired of being the small guy. I want to be the big guy. I want to be the guy with more power. I want to be the guy with better wrestling. And the other person who really showed me this format of dropping a weight class was Damian Maya, you know, a jiu-jitsu guy who dropped down to 170 pounds, and he started dominating great wrestlers. You know, he was taking down Rick Story. He took down Kim, you know, like, I mean, he was just dominating people. John Fish, I believe, you know, he took down two and he just totally dominated him. And I'm like, that's what I want to do. That's what I want to do at 145. I want to be the big guy. I want to be the big, strong, dominant wrestler of wrestlers. But at the same time, I want to have more power in my hands, more power in my kick. I want to use high kicks, I want to use knees, I want to use all these different dimensions that I wasn't able to use at 155 or 170 because the guys are so tall.
The original Ultimate Fighter, the first ever Ultimate Fighter winner, the last remaining member of the Ultimate Fighter 1, still on the UFC roster, still doing his thing, reinventing himself at 145, he makes his featherweight debut. November 21st, Monterrey, Mexico against Ricardo Lamas. What a fight that will be. Diego, always a pleasure to talk to you, my friend. It's great to have you back in the mix. Looking forward to that fight very much.
Thank you, Ariel. Thank you for your condolences. Jaden was a good kid, and this fight is dedicated to him. And, you know, so every training session, when I make that walk, people are like, this fight is in his remember, and I'm fighting for him this fight, and I'm gonna go out there and I'm gonna lay it all down the way I always do. But you know, I also have a lot of respect for Ricardo Lamas, and I just want to put that out there that, you know, I have a tremendous amount of respect for him. He's a big dude. There's no beef here. We respect each other, and it's gonna be a very respectful fight. But you know, once they lock that door, you know. He's got a family, I got a family, and we're fighting to feed our kids. So if you want to see a hell of a fight, tune into our fight, because that's going to be a hell of a fight. You know, it's not the main event. My boy Kelvin and Matt Brown, they're going to put on a great 5-round main event, but the co-main event is going to be, it's going to be vicious. With me and Ricardo, it's going to be vicious. So all you boxing fans who want to fight 10 hellos, if you do, you're going to be missing out on a real war, which is going to be Lamas Sanchez. It's going down November 21st, so tune in.
All the best to you, Diego. Talk to you soon.
Right,
there he is, Diego Sanchez. Great stuff from him, as always. Like I said, changing it up, switching it up, dropping down to 145. Big fight for him on November 21st. Let's move along. Let's go to our next guest. Lupar not patiently waiting for us, and you know, it's very nice that he has taken some time out of the day to join us, because if you follow him on Instagram, he's somewhere in Italy, all bronzed up, with his fiance on the beach. But, I mean, the guy's just living the dream. If this is what post-UFC life is like, Lupar not is doing it right, my friends. Here he is, match with Skype, big slow himself. How are you?
Very well, Eric. How are you?
Where are you right now?
I am actually back. Trip across
in the aftermath,
so, tranquil. Away from Malaga to Barcelona, and stopped off in Valencia, and spent a lot of time in Spain. Like I said, getting bronze. With my first, now I am home. Got my claws back now.
Okay, so I must apologize. I said Italy. You were in Spain, so my apologies to the Spanish for that. Why the in-laws, by the way? Have you moved in with the in-laws? Is this what's happening here?
We've got 2 weeks of wedding. So the wedding's up here in Liverpool. I'm up here preparing, obviously sorting out all the last minute things. So, you know, I got to be on ground zero.
What's the mood like? Are we nervous? Are we anxious? Are we excited? Are we what's it like?
I mean, I'm very excited. I think you get nervous the last couple of days, maybe, or the day before. I don't know, you tell me. But I'm excited to make it happen. Now, I'm waiting a long time for it. I know what I'm actually going to do. So, you know, I'm really excited today. Everyone tells me it just goes too fast. So I'm going to try and remember it and have a good time.
So you said it's in 2 weeks, right?
2 weeks Wednesday, yeah.
So that's weird because, you know, I remember you saying we're best friends and all in 2 weeks. I know the mail is slow, but I still haven't received my... Is this an internet one? Is it like one of the email ones? Or
you are more than welcome to come here. I'm sure I sent something out to your email. Check your junk.
Okay.
Make sure you
invite
away. Definitely
invite. Okay. Okay, so let's break some news here. You have found recently you parted ways with the UFC, still hoping to one day resume your career there, but for now, you have found a suitor. Let us know.
Yeah, you know, obviously I left the UFC a little while back, and I've been searching for the right company to take me forward, the right people to take me forward. I've had a lot of offers coming in from loads of different places. It's quite a surprising company. I think people will be surprised who I've decided to go with. They're quite a new startup. But there's a company out of Italy, which you mentioned earlier, named Venator FC, the Venator Fighting Championship. They've had, I believe it's 5 shows now, but they are on the television in Fox.
You don't want
and they've been done like an Italian version of The Ultimate Fighter, where they've pitched Italians against each other. And they've done a 13-week series of this show. Where they've built it up. They haven't had it in their house like The Ultimate Fighter, they've just been fighting. And it's become very popular over there, and now they built a show off of that. So they had a reality TV program around mixed martial arts in Italy, and now they've brought a big show to Venator FC, which they've now recruited me to fight their middleweight final. There's a guy named Matteo Cavalla, who's the best middleweight in Italy, the number one ranked Italian middleweight. And he recruited me to come in fight the final on December 12th in Rimini, right next to Bologna. I believe that's right.
Yeah. So we're talking Italy here. Of course, you're European, you're from England. Why'd you choose, and I know there are some, you know, some organizations in the UK, around the UK. Why'd you choose Italy and not one of the English promotions?
Well, you know, one of the big advantages I had with the UFC was travel. I actually fought on 3 different continents for the UFC. I got to fight in Asia, in America, and in Europe. And that's one of the things I've now, the greatest thing with not being with the UFC is the power to choose your own destiny, do what you want to do, and see where you want to be. And I wanted to travel a little bit. And I think Venator is trying to really upstage those promotions and really push European MMA. And a lot of guys in England, without the Cage Warriors, obviously with Willis, he's coming back, but I'm not sure it'll come back with the force that it had before. And without Cage Warriors, there's a real void in Europe for a very, very solid MMA promotion. And Venator hired Mark Goddard to be in charge of all of their safety and all of their refereeing and all of their judging and so forth, the backstage. They're very serious about making it a clean, great event. The fighters are like, very vital. And, you know, I met with Frank Miranda, if I say his name correctly. I met him for lunch. We had a long discussion about what I was trying to look for. You know, they are just investing in the fighters and trying to have a good fighters organization, and they're worrying about everything else like this. So, you know, a lot of organizations that they start up and they don't last. I mean, hopefully Bellator is gonna last the time. They have the Fox deal in Italy. They're the only MMA show shown on Fox apart from the UFC. So I feel really, really, really good about it. And like I said, I've never been to Italy, one of the only countries I've not been to in Europe. So I just don't want to go.
Did they reach out to you or vice versa?
My teammates, a very good teammate of mine, probably, well, the guy who got martial arts, Jack Mason, actually fought on their last show. And I spoke to him about it. And then we had a training partner together. He was Italian, and he reached out to me on their behalf. And I said, oh, sounds interesting, let me speak. And then we got chatting. So technically, they reached out to me, but it was more of a mutual thing.
And is this a one fight deal? Or at least you're fighting for a belt, so. What kind of contract, what kind of deal do you have with them?
It's literally just a two-fight deal. Okay. So we have two fights. They've got the next show in December, and then they're going to show in May. So there's a little bit of gap in between. But within that contract, I'm not exclusively signed to them at all. I'm signed with them, and they're my number one client, if you will, as a contractor. And then I can look for other organizations to work with them. And I'm looking for one more organization to fill the gap, because I want to get as many fights as I possibly can. And I want to fight people all over the world, like you said, so I'm trying to get as many fights as I possibly can to get myself back.
So who else are you talking to?
We've been talking to an organization in South Africa called EFC, who are huge over there in Africa. They're the only MMA show shown on television, and they're very, very good out there. And I'm in contact with them, and I'm hoping that'll be the organization I go with. Apart from that, there's been bits and bobs going around, but nothing solid. I'm literally looking for the fights that I can get to take me back to the UFC. So I want good fights with good people and good organizations that are clean. You know, and I'm really trying to push the sport forward, and I feel like I'm a good representative for them. So I'm just trying to push that.
So you're up front with these executives. You're telling them, look, I'm happy to come, I want to sign, but if the UFC comes calling, that's what I want. That's my end goal here, right?
Yeah, and most organizations know that. Yeah. You know, now, at this stage, they're making sure that the contract of, like, break laws that the UFC come calling, that I can leave and go there. And that was one of the reasons I didn't go looking towards that. You know, because they're obviously competitors or whatever you want to call it. And there's a lot of that. There are a lot of people I respect and like there. It wasn't the right fit for me. I've been fighting barely 2 years, and I got in the Ultimate Fighter, and went through that process, was in the UFC, was very, very fast. You know, I've only been doing the sport 6 years, and I was fighting Mark Munoz, who I wanted that fight, and I still wanted that fight, and I'm glad I had that fight. But, you know, it all went very, very quickly for me, and I felt like I handled it very well. I enjoyed my time with the UFC. I had some great fights. I learned a lot from it. And I feel like once I get there again, I will be a much better suited athlete for the sport, and I can do much better things.
Will you still be training at Alliance?
For the European fights, no. It's not worth the investment to go out there and train. If I was fighting in the US, I would have. But to go over there and fly back to Europe, it's not going to happen. I'm actually moving to Malaga, Spain, which is why I was out there looking. I'm actually moving there on September 6th with my fiance to live.
Really?
So I'll be training. Well, because I fell in love with the sunshine in San Diego, and England doesn't have it, basically. Yeah. It's always been my fiance's dream to live abroad in Spain, and she, her work, she wants to work in England and in Spain back and forth. So, you know, she followed my dream for a long time and helped me out. She lived with me in San Diego and all the rest of it. So it's a small repayment to her. And then I'm going to travel for camps. At the moment, I'm looking at one country, but I'm looking to train in Sweden right now for the fights.
All-Stars?
But I'm looking at All-Stars, but I don't think that would be the right thing. I'm
probably
looking to train with an old friend of mine from the Ultimate Fighter, a guy named Thor Tran.
Mm.
He has his own gym in Umeå, or Umeå, I can't say it, it's Sweden. It's about 2 hours away from Stockholm. We're very, very good friends. He has a small outfit there. I've tried big gyms like Alliance, and I've been to All Stars a couple of times. I know the coaches very well, but I think if I have a smaller outfit where I'm the main focus for this fight, I feel like it'll be a very good outfit for me. And the sword suits Mattia Chevalier, the guy I'm fighting. He's like the perfect match for him. He can emulate very well, so as we grow closer, it'll be a much better fit.
Shortly after leaving the UFC, you were actually right back in the mix because your friend Arnold Allen was fighting on the card. You were there, fight week and all that. What was that like for you? Was that strange?
It was tough. I don't know what was tough. Obviously, I was extremely happy for Arnold if he got a bonus that night, but I was amazing. Came back from losing to such a big guy and still out. A very, very tough guy, so he made a bit of a noise. But the fight week itself was hard. I'm very close to the start. Very well, and they're all talking to me. And, you know, everyone you see thinks you're in the UFC or not in the UFC, or they're confused, and you've got to explain it, and then. The weirdest one, I think, was a Wednesday or the Thursday night. All the staff go out. They had some guest fighters. I can't remember what it was. They went to some bar. And I just had to go out. You know, I got on the van. I went to the venue. Everything. And I'm not supposed to. I'm not allowed. I'm not in the UFC anymore. But I went, tag along. You've got fans speaking to you. And, yeah, I was lucky enough that there. So we had some good chats. It was great. I mean, he showed me one last and just seeing the people was hard. I think the organization at that time, cool part of it. Even just the PR girls.
Wow, that's really hard to block.
It was tough to see them again.
Yeah, I thought of that right away, you know, seeing you fight with all that, I give you a lot of credit. You're a great teammate and friend because you didn't share with the world that this was hard, but just sort of knowing you a little bit and just, you know, normal human being reaction. I was like, wow, this is almost like divorcing your wife and then still kind of hanging out or working with her. It's hard to make a comparison, but you know what I'm saying. It's a strange feeling, but you handled it very well. So now here you are. You're going to make your debut for this organization December 12th. What does Luke Barnard have? If I get one win here, I'll get back in the UFC. Is it a slow build? How do you enter this new phase of your career? You're about to get married. All this stuff changing in a short amount of time. How do you enter this fight?
I don't think I have to prove. You know, like I said, I think it's very quick what happened in the UFC and how I got there. I think I handled it very, very well. I still believe that we can say 4-2, but I believe my record is 5-1 UFC, which is a great one for 6 fights. And I'll hold on to that.
Well done.
It's a tough thing to leave and to come back. I'm not looking to have one fight and get back to the UFC. I mean, I'm looking to reinvent myself, change my style. There's a lot of improvements I need to make, but I've skipped because of the speed that it took me to get to the UFC. You know, silly things like stretching. I'm probably the least flexible man. I'm 6'6" and the least flexible man on the planet, so I can incorporate a lot more head kicks, push kicks, put on my Thai boxing, which is the style I originally had. But getting to the UFC and having to pick up on that wrestling so quickly, going training around the world and living out of suitcases for the last 2 years of my life, definitely had an impact. So what I want to try and do is have more of a home life, a much better home life, a much stable home life where I'm training, enjoying my training, and I'm not chasing what I can become. I'm actually building it from there. And then when I feel like I get to the UFC, because I'm extremely 100% confident I'll be back there. Maybe 2, 3, 4, 5 fights. I'm not bothered about trying to get back there as soon as possible. When I feel ready and I've won the fights that I feel deserve to get back to the UFC, I'll give Joe Silver a call. We had a chat when it all went south, and he spoke to me about me getting released and how he felt about it. They want to have me back in the UFC. I just have to prove myself to them that I can win the fights and get back there.
Cheers, my friend. I wish you nothing but the best. Thank you so much for coming on the show. Congratulations to both you and your fiance on the upcoming wedding. Enjoy that process. All right, just enjoy this ride. Have fun. Have a great night with your family and friends. And I look forward to your debut in December. I'm sure I'll talk to you before then.
I appreciate it, Errol. Thank you very much for having me on, and trust
Dang,
me,
there's not just player no earlier that showed me that combo.
Planning tables, seating plans, yeah, whatever it is, all that stuff. So I'll be fine. Yeah, I'm going to concentrate on the fight after the win.
And by the way, if you can avoid fighting about that stuff, good luck to you. Boy, was that an annoying process damaged, when I went through it. So it's a different kind of fighting, but yeah, have fun with that. As they say in Italy, ciao ragazzo, bellissimo.
Bellissimo, ciao ragazzo.
There he is. Big Slow, Luke Barnard joining. Bellator FC. As he mentioned, new organization out of Italy. They've been to a few shows. I checked out their website, and it's a nice-looking website, if that's any indication of who they are, what they do, what they put together. Nice job. Now, I think something that he said that was really interesting was, you know, some people, when they get released, they talk about UFC getting, you know, getting back in there with the UFC, and it's important not to rush that, because I always feel like those fighters who do that, they stumble. At some point, they inevitably stumble, because they keep looking past the fights that they need to get back into the UFC. And it sounds like Luke's on the side. He's talking about it, and that's his own goal, and he's always talking about that, which is fine. But you can't look past the points that you need to conquer in order to get back into the UFC, because you weren't looking past those fights on the way to the UFC initially. So by doing that now, you're only doing a disservice to yourself. It seems like he's figuring it out. It seems like he's trying to get it all together, and we wish him the best. Great guy. An incredibly smart man when it comes to fighting. Tremendous analyst, as I've said before. He has a future in media, no doubt. But for now, he is chasing that dream once again, and I look forward to watching that journey. Wish him the best. All right, let's move along. You know, I said on Saturday that it has become a common theme these days. It seems like almost every UFC card, every big time card, post-fight interview, fighter gets on the mic. Thanks, Mike Brown. Thanks, Mike Brown, for his coaching, for his tutelage, for his training, for being there in their corner. This has become somewhat common. Former WC featherweight champion Mike Brown, one of my favorite people in MMA. What? It has become common, and then when Amanda Nunes won on Saturday night, in my opinion, the big story of Saturday night in Nashville, she defeated Sarah. Incredibly impressive performance. Dominant win. She is in that mix, as they say. Thank Mike Brown. I said it is high time to get the former champ on the show to talk about his transition coaching, which he is doing so damn well. So here he is, joining us via the Magic of Skype, the one and only Mike Brown. Mike, how are you?
I'm great, man. Thanks for having me on.
A pleasure, as always. It's been a while since we had you on. Now, here you are transitioning. Like I said, I saw something on Twitter, and I forget the number. How many weeks in a row, how many events have you just completed?
It's been a rough stretch. 10 out of 12 weeks I've been on the road. 11 shows in 12 weeks.
Wow.
Yeah, it's been a lot.
You enjoy that?
It's a little much. I love what I do, but I feel like I'm turning into a professional cornerman, not a road trip. Like, I'm almost on the road too much. I gotta try to go out later, or it was just so many good guys that are fighting a lot. Sometimes it stretches me thin, but I have some time off now.
Okay, so looking at, let's say, the rest of the calendar year, do you feel like it's going to scale back? Was this just, you know, I talked about on the beginning of this show, 15 UFC events in 14 weeks. So it's been busy for everyone. Do you feel like you'll be able to figure it out?
Yeah, I think it'll slow down now.
Okay.
Yeah, it was just a busy time. I don't even know the next time I go out. Oh, my next time will be, I'm guessing, with Dustin Poirier. Probably the next time I'll travel. Something might pop up.
So are you a full-time coach now?
Full-time coach.
MMA is done. The fighting is done.
Yeah, it's weird. I just never, I never officially retired. I just kind of faded off, and I didn't want to make a big deal of it, you know. But I'm retired, you know.
You retired. Was it hard to come to that realization?
There's parts I miss, parts I don't. So, you know, I love my job. I couldn't ask for a better job. I'm in love with the sport, man. The sport has been great for me, and it was always a huge passion for me. And I couldn't ask for a cooler job, man. Just hanging out with high-level talent, you know, working on techniques and playing around with the game. You know, it doesn't get better than that.
Did it make the transition easier because you just, you know, you took your foot out of the fighting door, and now you're in the coaching door, you're still in the same gym. You're still surrounded by the same people. It's not like you have to go out there and find a 9-to-5 job, and now here you are, the doctor system. Your world has changed. Did that make it easier?
No, I mean, it was super easy because I actually, like, I was before my last fight, I was so I had neck surgery. Maybe 12. So I was out training hard for a while. So I started coaching kind of spot position in 2012. And then from there, I was like kind of playing both, trying to coach and fight, but it was a better fit for just me to step back and start coaching full time.
How does that work at ATP? Like, you go up to the guys who are like Oreo or Conan, and you go up to them and say, hey, this is something I want to be today, we're going to prove you and say, we see this in you. How did you get to that point where you became the first person that full-time member?
That was Lebo, man. Lebo for years, man. It's always, you know, we always talk, and we've always been close. He's always said, hey, man, I really want you to, when you're done, help us out and continue on. And, we had a good relationship. That was a good fit for the team. And a better home, man. I mean, this is my
life.
It's like a family, man. And you know, I'll be here forever.
On this particularly crazy stretch, what's the performance you're most proud of? Fight!
Deathbreaker! So many, and like in this stretch, I think Poirier probably fought twice, finished both guys in the first round. That's impressive. Amanda is damn close to a title shot. Kimbo dug himself out of a grave. He was in big trouble and somehow ended up on top. There are many, many fights.
I got a kick out of that one, seeing you and Kimbo in that corner. I mean, what an experience that must have been. What was it like for you to be a part of, you know, I don't say this disparagingly, but it's somewhat of a circus, right? I mean, it was Kimbo versus Ken and the bad blood and all that, and you're there and he gets kicked down. Yeah, what was it like for you?
A lot of people watched him, you know, it's pretty crazy. And man, he got taken down right away. I mean, Ken was smart. Ken, like, wanted to get into the world. He was just like, boom, right to the takedown. He fought very smart, but he battled out of like near death, man. He was like books in, Ken punched the rear naked, but he kind of had it on top of the head, and, you know, he like, he was a little loose, and Kimbo's got a lot of heart, man. He just kept fighting, and then right when he got back to the wall, man, he killed him with a wicked shot, you know, that shit on his head, man. You could see it, but you could like see the bone.
Oh,
it was so. Oh. He had a hole in his head.
Any word on his next fight yet?
Amazing. I don't know what's going on. He's been back in the gym since, man. Started trying to train. You know, that's his manager's role. They're looking at something. I'm not certain. That's not my job.
And what about Amanda? It really felt like, you know, I remember when she made her Strikeforce debut, I believe also in Nashville. She blew the doors off of Julia Budd in a matter of seconds. And she had a nice run. Silverman, a couple stumbles here and there, but on Saturday against, you know, super tough opponent, silver medalist in the Olympics, of course, Sarah McMahon. It really seemed like it all came together for her. Had that killer instinct, she looked fantastic. Why now does it seem like it all came together for Amanda?
I mean, I can't say for sure, but she's only been with us for the last couple fights.
Yeah.
But I'll say 100%, this is the first girl, you know, like, I've ever seen in the gym where I was like, looked and I was like, whoa, you know, like, I've seen her literally stop guys in the gym.
Instantly connected.
Like, I mean, beating dudes up, making guys quit, like in the stand-up. And she just from really grappling background. But I've seen her, like, make dudes quit, like kickboxing in the gym. Fight! It's impressive.
What weight are these guys that she's fighting with?
You know, 25ers, 35ers. Guys her size.
Okay.
I mean, they're not like, I'm not talking Dustin Poirier or Texas, but professional fighters, you know, that are very tough. She's like beaten up, and she can be mean too. You know, she's like you know, getting after him, and guys are like timid, and she's like the alpha for sure, you know?
Yeah, is she ready for on that?
Seems that's important. I think she is.
Really?
I think her stand up is light years ahead of her. But, obviously, you know, Ronda is super talented. The best, you know? You have to, like, you have to use good footwork and score and move and try to stay off the ground because Ronda's, you know, a phenom on the ground. But I mean, I don't think Ronda's stand up is Amanda's level.
So in your perfect world, does she, you know, fight once, twice more, or in your perfect world, if you're booking things, do you think, all right, let's put her in there, let's see how she does.
Man, I don't know, man. I'm not a manager, you know.
But you're the coach.
I'm not a manager.
You know better than
that's
that.
That's the thing. You know, I think that she can always improve. You know, I think that you get better with another fight. I don't know what the right choice is. You take the risk of losing a fight because, you know, sometimes the better fighter doesn't always win. You know, sometimes you take a risk and somebody beats you that maybe you're better than, but you get caught. You know, that happens all the time. So, I mean, I think she can beat Ronda now, but I mean, I don't know. Maybe you try to build her a little more, get a little more experience. But, I mean, she's more than capable.
Months ago, Robbie Lawler said that one of the keys to his less sparring. And last week on this show, Dustin Poirier echoed the same sentiment. Perhaps he does it a little more than Robbie, but he's definitely dialed back. Why is this being done at ATT, and do you subscribe to the theory as well? Do you feel like fighters are far left?
Yeah, I mean, guys are still sparring, but they're not, I mean, they're not killing themselves, not going to war, you know, two or three times a week. Maybe once, twice a week. I mean, those guys still spar. Don't get me wrong. But, I mean, there was a big thing about Robbie where he said he wasn't sparring for years, right?
Yeah.
But this was kind of a thing. But then, lately, he's been killing it. Obviously, he's the best fighter in the world at 170 pounds. And he's sparring now.
He is.
So, I mean, I think it's all about finding balance.
Okay.
But once you're, especially when you're higher level guy,
he's back to sparring.
Denied. Yeah, he spars.
Okay.
No doubt. But I think, I mean, there was a period where he didn't spar at all. You know, like for years. And then I think when he came to ATT, he started sparring more. I mean, I think Tommy Barzini runs most of his training. He's a high-level coach at the gym. He runs a lot of his sparring. He has some sparring. I mean, not a lot. And maybe he doesn't spar. He definitely doesn't spar when he doesn't have a fight coming up. But they know how to balance things. They balance very well.
Injuries have plagued this sport for quite some time. As a coach and as a former fighter, have you kind of figured out what's the right amount of how you should push yourself for these fights? Because it seems like so many fights over the last 5 years have gone up in smoke because of an injury. How do you find that balance?
Yeah, I mean, that's a tricky thing.
Are you guys evolving?
I mean,
did you feel like it's evolving?
Better by playing the game. The way you improve most is by playing the game. But by playing the game, there's a lot of injuries. So you gotta play the game just enough not to get hurt. Do enough drills, and then try to learn as much as you can with the drills, and then test it out by sparring. And then back to more drills. I mean, you need to do both. It's a tricky balance, for sure.
But you feel, you know, I've heard of a lot of fighters, including our last guest, who are now saying, you know, I need to be
the aftermath
center focus. You know, I can't be a part of a big gym anymore because I get lost in the shuffle. It's too crowded, things like that. It needs to be more like boxing, you know, where the camp is built around me. How do you feel about that? Fight!
You know, I was listening to Luke say that.
Yeah.
I mean, there's different arguments. That can be true.
Denied.
When you're in a small camp, you have all the coaches attending, right? Like, the coach is 100% on you. That's all, you know, focus is. But you don't have a that's what
he does so much damage.
You know, closes up any little hole or gap in your game. Like say if you're a wrestler, you know, if you're from a wrestler from a small state, that's me, man. I grew up in Maine. Shout out to all the maniacs out there.
Yeah.
But yes. If you're from Maine, man, like it's hard. The level of competition is not super high. If you try to go to wrestle in Pennsylvania or go to Iowa University, you know, you just don't have that high level of guys around you all the time to push you. And that's the same with a small camp. You need like super high level guys. Not pushing you, I think, finding your holes. Because then once they find the holes, you tighten them up. You know, if a guy takes you down 5 times in a row with a double leg, you're gonna figure a way on your own to stop that takedown. But if nobody's taking you down, or nobody's cracking you with a straight right hand in training, then you think you're fine, but maybe you're not.
Can you give me a name of a youngster, he may not be in the UFC or Bellator, but someone that's climbing the ranks at ATT that you are particularly excited about? It could be someone in the UFC, but someone that you've been working with that you think has championed, has come to mind?
Yeah, you know, if you talk about something like that, a guy that's... I mean, he's already kind of made it. Like, Mursad Bekdic, he's one of those guys. Everyone is really sure of that. Everything's in line. He has the genetics, the capability, the drive, the will, you know, like, everything he needs to do it. And he's on the right path. So he's one of the guys that will be there. But he's already there. He's already there. He's already there. I mean, most of the guys that are in on our team that should be there are there now. With the exception of Nate Coy is a guy who belongs there that's not in there.
The strong must protect the weak.
Nate Coy belongs in the UFC. And another young guy, Jamie Alvarez, is a 25-pounder.